Hey, what are you doing here? Hey there, that's a pretty sweet tractor. Want to trade?
Guys, how we doing? Welcome to the channel. I've got a tough decision in front of me today, trying to decide which of these two tractors am I gonna keep, the 4066 or the 4720. I've been feeling the itch to get a new machine. I just didn't know what I wanted to do. There's not much out there in the used market. I didn't want to go new. I thought about getting a Kubota, but I wasn't gonna go that far. Actually, I did look pretty hard for a L6060, but I couldn't find one. Recently, I sold my bigger John Deere, my 5115M, to a customer who actually had purchased this tractor from me in the fall. They did a few upgrades to it. They wanted my 5115, so I bought this back from on trade. I think the stars are aligning. Plus, I like mixing things up. I like giving you guys different perspective. This is gonna be a little bit older, a little bit higher hour machine. Not really high hours in the grand scheme of things. There's only about 800 hours on it, but it's a chance for me to demonstrate to you guys that 800 hours is no big deal. I mean, it's almost 10 years old. Let's just use round numbers there. So that's 80 hours a year of use. It's really nothing. These machines, we've talked about it before at length in videos, they go thousands and thousands of hours. So I don't want you to be scared when you see an older tractor that's got 800 hours, even 1,000. You know, depending on the kind of condition, which you can tell walking around it, just feeling it out. Look at those wear points there on the bucket, on the loader arms, maybe on the tires, on the axles, different areas on the machine will give you a good feel for what it's all about and kind of the history, even if you can't get that information from the seller. Guys, I am proud to be sponsored by Bora Wheel Spacers, and one of these two machines is gonna get a set of Boras on it really soon. Gotta make that tough decision. I know a lot of you guys are grappling with that new versus old, so stick around, you're gonna get a good comparison, strengths, weaknesses, pros, cons of going newer, older. Bora's gonna help you out either way. Lateral stability, side to side, these machines just have that tippy feeling naturally. So get yourself a stability solution, link down below. And if you want to help the channel out, give me a thumbs up, hit that subscribe button, and make sure to check out goodworkstractors.com. Okay, question for you guys. Leave a comment down below if you know the answer, but there's some extra steel. These bars that are resting on top of the three-point arms, they kind of left me confused in the beginning. I know the answer now. I'll let you know at the end of the video. If you think you know what it is, leave a comment down below. Now, it's no secret I absolutely love my 4066R. I'd highly recommend it to anybody on the market. This 4720 is as close to it as you can get. You know, I just love to mix things up, try out new equipment. I have the opportunity to do so, so why not? Now, I tell you, that Kubota L6060 is pretty close to being the exact equivalent of this John Deere model right here. There's a lot of other large frame compact tractors as well, but this is as big as you can go and still be a hydrostatic machine, which for me and the other folks at my shop that use it, that's a pretty important key there versus having to go with some sort of a power reverser or another gear shift that's just a little bit less efficient for the type of operations that we're doing. So visually looking at these two tractors, they're really similar. You know, the cabs, virtually identical, the structure, the tires, everything else. You see this belly mower down here, that's really of no value to me. They don't actually make a mid PTO or a belly mower any longer. You can't buy that with a newer generation, the 4R, the 4066, which encompasses several models. So I'm gonna take this mower off and store it, just not gonna use it for the right person, the right application. Eventually when I sell it, it'll be of value to them, I'm sure. What intrigued me the most was actually this extra bracketry here, which makes this a self-leveling loader or MSL loader. I'd been looking for a while for another 4R series tractor to swap loaders and make mine an MSL or a self-leveling loader, just wasn't able to do so. And the reason why is that when we use this at our shop, primarily with pallet forks, we're able to lift those loads really level without having to feather the joystick. You simply fork it in, you raise up, and it's gonna keep that level load no matter what's on the pallet, it's not gonna spill off. So pay attention, if you are used tractor shopping, this could potentially open up a lot of doors or windows for you, because with the John Deere and the 3R and the 4R series tractors, the 4R is equivalent to that 4X20. So your 4720, 4520, 4320, 4120. Same thing with the 3R tractors, your 3046, 3039, 3033R. Those are equivalent to, let's see, your 3720, 3520, 3320, and 3120. But we're talking about things like your lifting capacity on the loader, on the 3-point, your engine horsepower relatively equal. They may tweak here, they're just a little bit. Most often the changes are gonna be something that's like the layout, maybe controls are in a different spot here or there. I will say the hitch assist that's on the 4R was not found on the 4720. So that's a change, but that's pretty minor in the grand scheme of things, but all the bells and whistles that I have on my 4066 that I haven't added aftermarket are found on this 4720. So even though I'm going 4 years back in the past, I still have a lot of those convenience features that I want. So items such as the electrohydraulic third function control, you have the fourth and the fifth rear outlets on the back, grapple lines ran up front, a deluxe grill guard, an air ride seat, tilt steering, cab with air and heat, the list kind of goes on. So I say all that to help you out because right now it is very tough to find a tractor. And if you're looking for something that has certain requirements and you think it can only be one specific model, this will give you some more opportunities to look for in your search, which could be nationwide. I mentioned a third, fourth, and a fifth remote. So you have a third, a fourth, and a fifth remote. For some, that may be enough, but for many, myself included, we needed a whole lot more than that. We've got a solution for you. This add-on right here can expand your capability way beyond what's offered from John Deere. I'm gonna explain very quickly on how you can really add up and have to utilize all these additional outlets. For me, I have a hydraulic top link and a hydraulic side link. That's two extra functions that I have tied up over here. And then we've got one of these extra functions on this hydraulic multiplier fed into the hydraulic third function. With this 6-port multiplier, you have 5 additional functions available. The snowblower that I ran this winter on the backside right here where I'm standing required 3 additional circuits. 1, 2, 3. One to rotate the chute, one to adjust the deflector, and another to raise and lower the back drag. If I ran a hydraulic snowplow on the front, this would take up the fifth and leave me one to spare. So you can see right there, depending on what your application is, it could be in the summertime with a hydraulic flail mower, could be a baler, could be a top and tilt angling blade, all sorts of different pieces of equipment on the backside and the front side with a grapple too. They all plug in back here. The great thing about this, it's a DIY solution. You can get it with just a couple extra ports, maybe a few, or maybe all 6 like what you see here. The best part is you get 5% off using code GWT. You go to Summit Hydraulics, a link down below in the description. They ship it right to you, free shipping as well right now. Okay, so we're inside the cab of the 4720. I mean, it is not identical, but it's really, really close. I will say, for some reason, it feels just slightly smaller front to back. It could just all be in my head. I feel like I've got the seat back as far as it goes, but I'd be surprised if these cabs weren't identical in proportion. But beyond that, everything from the radio, the sunglass holder, all the vents, the visor, the in-cab mirror, the climate controls, you name it, up top, this is virtually identical up here. Moving down, this fender location, the cubbies, the parking brake, your range selector, that's all identical. Up on the display up here around the steering wheel, it's almost identical. You're gonna have a slightly few different knobs and buttons, but nothing that's dramatic. And then moving over to the right fender, it is a little different. They've got a more refined, I guess I would say, little cluster of controls for like cruise control and your rollout adjustment and auto throttle, that kind of thing. But all the buttons are just individual here. One of the cool things that the previous owner added on, I didn't have it when I first bought this tractor, but he added it, was the fourth and the fifth outlet. And that's not the cool part, it is cool, but there's actually a couple little just buttons, just little toggle switches that you use to engage the fourth and the fifth instead of the big levers like my 4066 has. I've never seen that before. Even the air ride seat control is the same, but I will say that the upholstery on the seat is just a little bit different. And we learned something new today. This seat back was actually leaning a little bit too far forward, kind of uncomfortable, and we kept looking around for a control to try to adjust it. I've never had to adjust it on my 4066. It was just in the right spot. There's actually just a little lever right here that you can go backwards, forwards, whatever you want to do, and lock it in place. It took us a minute because it was just hiding just right next to the seat belt, but there it is. So besides the paint color, the back of these two machines looked really similar. The only difference was this rod that's resting on top of those lower arms, and it took me quite a while to figure out what it was. So finally I went down a little bit further and reached underneath to see what it was connected to, and I realized, oh yeah, this thing's got a belly mower on it. So what this is doing is raising and lowering the 3-point hitch. Those brackets are tied into the lifting mechanism for the mower deck. So when you raise up the 3-point hitch, that mower deck raises up, and when you lower it back down, you guessed it, so does the mower deck. So you will see this is a one-piece hood design, which I really like. You can take the side panels off of the 4066. Not that big of a deal to do, but it is nice just to have everything in one piece. I wish they would have kind of kept this design, if you ask me. Also, and I don't particularly mind either way, but some of you do, this is going to be pre-emission. So you do just have a regular muffler on here. There's not going to be any Tier 4 compliance, no DPF, no burning off the exhaust and everything else. One more thing to go wrong. Overall, it's not really problematic with the DPF, the diesel particulate filter, which simply is kind of like a soot collector. Gets to a certain point, it senses it, it tells you to rev up the engine to get enough heat generated so it can burn off the buildup. That's all that is, but stay away from the B3350. That is the one that really has the prevalent issues, but none of the other models out there are really experiencing any kinds of issues with those exhaust systems on them. They've been around for 7-8 years now, so they would have reared their ugly head by now if that was the case. Okay, so I'm curious to know what you guys would do. You know, I am leaning one direction. Now, if I were to keep the 4720, I would swap over the wheels and the tires and the weights. I'd add on a multiplier. I'd get it set up the same way that my 4066 is, but I don't know if I want to go through all that work or not. I will say the price probably isn't that far off between these two setups. You know, that one's newer than that one, but this one is a unicorn. I did the video called Unicorn all about this machine here because it's got that belly mower on there. There's so few of them that are out there. That really helps to increase the value because of the mower deck itself, plus the scarcity of it too. So if you're in the market and trying to decide between one or the other of these series of tractors, the best advice I can give you is you can't go wrong either way. Alrighty guys, that's gonna do it. Hopefully this gives you a little bit more of an education, realizing there's more options on the market for you, especially in these trying times when it's impossible to find used inventory. Hey guys, and if you enjoyed this video, it would mean a lot to me if you take those extra few seconds, find that like button, smash it, hit that subscribe button if you haven't done so already, and then head on over to goodworkstractors.com. You'll find all sorts of cool stuff for your machine over there. Thanks again for stopping by, and until next time, stay safe. We'll see you soon.